statistics in biopsychology. And I actually got my master's degree here and then was dumb enough to come back for a PhD. I say that facetiously, I'm almost done, but I never realized exactly how hard it would be until I was in the middle of it going, what have I done with my life? But it has been going the right way. It is a wonderful program. When I am not teaching, I own a private practice with two locations, one that is in Waynesburg and one that is in Washington with four other providers. And we focus on veteran culture, trauma, anxiety, and depression. I am an EMDR provider, which means, if nobody has ever heard of that before, basically using eye movement to heal trauma. When I'm not doing that, I'm a major in the Army Reserves. And for a short stint, people always ask me, what got you interested in veteran culture and suicide and all of the things that nobody else really wants to talk about? And it came out of 17 years of service in the Army, both active duty and the reserves, and then becoming a suicide prevention manager for the Army Reserve. And at one point, I had the entire Eastern Seaboard, which is about 7,000 soldiers, and I was the only counselor. And I spent a lot of time working with universities and hospitals and providers telling them about veteran culture, because if you don't understand, you're like, oh, I just get it, they'll be fine. But you don't realize the suicide rate. You don't realize the dropout rate. You don't realize the cultural specific indicators that need to be infused into education and into counseling for people to really feel as if they're recognized in a session, in their community, in a classroom, wherever they may be a part of after they leave service or are currently serving in the reserve. Does that seem reasonable? It does, right? So there are a bunch of slides. I am not going to focus on all of them. Nobody run out screaming, promise. But I did include some that I have recently done for the Mental Health Academy. And they are out of the United States, the UK, and Australia. And I've been doing a webinar series for them on teaching providers across the world how to work with veterans. And we do it for charity. We've actually raised $25,000 so far this year for underserved population. And they keep bringing me back, so I'll be back in D.C. this May talking about accumulated stress and leadership in the reserve, as well as active shooter violence and how to mitigate it in corporations. So I'll be doing both of those events for them this year. So without further ado, I will get started. I talk super fast and super loud. I've had three company commands. So if anybody loses me, and I have two boys. It's a joke. Four dogs, three cats, two boys, and a husband. A very busy person. And if I start to misspeak, you can yell at Jill Sunday, because she used to be my boss in the Writing Center as her graduate assistant. And she's the one who talked me into doing some of these webinars and things. She said, no, you should do it. There's no reason why you shouldn't do it. You should go do it. So I want to say thank you to her up front. She's one of the people that really drove me along to Pepper to keep moving forward. So bottom line up front, 11 to 20% of veterans have PTSD. That means 81% don't, right? We're looking at like 80 to 90% that are walking around that don't have what we would traditionally describe as post-traumatic stress disorder. But what do we think of when we think about veterans and suicide? Post-traumatic stress disorder. So a lot of veterans would come to me, and a lot of currently serving, and say, nobody gets it, they just want to ask me what's wrong with me. Or they're waiting for me to be broken. Or they think I'm just going to lose my mind. And I'm starting to feel like I'm the one that's crazy. I said, well, how can we address this? Well, can you help us train people on culture? Because the military is now, by the American Counseling Association, a cultural group that is deemed studyable and treatable and is separated off from people lobbying. Things like financial stress, family separations, managing two jobs. Like I said, when I'm not doing this and being in my practice, I'm also an executive officer for a battalion that has two units deployed. So this morning I was taking phone calls, driving in, ma'am, we're drilling this weekend, you could be in Harrisburg by midnight tomorrow. Those things are always happening, but we're not aware of them. The why. If you understand veteran culture, you are more apt to not only help somebody, but to help yourself if you are a counselor or educator. You are more likely to have somebody stay in counseling and more likely to have somebody stay enrolled because they felt understood. There is nothing worse for reservists when they have to call their commander and say, I'm failing my semester because I went to annual training. Or my counselor can't understand why I disappeared for 3 weeks. They're not understanding what I'm saying. The other piece of this is a lack of familiarization has some counselors saying, I don't want to touch it. Go to the VA. What have we heard about the VA in the news recently? Yeah. They're backed up. I love the VA, I work a lot with them, I collaborate, but there's like a 4-week wait for a mental health appointment. That's a long time if you're somebody that really needs to be seen. But if you call a local counselor, they're gonna say, you know what, I have the expert for you, I'm gonna get you in touch with the VA. And that person goes, I don't wanna go to the VA. That's why I'm calling you. So that lack of familiarization has caused this kind of, I'm not an expert, I'm gonna refer you, when really we need to be experts. The same way that we are experts in counseling, we talk about any type of multicultural inclusion, whether that be by race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, they all need to be included. Objectives. When I typically teach this, I talk about culture-specific indicators. I talk about risks and barriers to treatment, but also about strengths. And I talk about subcultures. It's not just one military. It's not just one type of soldier. And within that, it's not just one type of family. And I also teach language so people can understand what someone's saying and understand that maybe they're not being overly critical, that's just how you think. And then understanding how to connect people with regional and national resources. They're already in place, and if they're not used, they'll lose funding. We have some great programs that we just don't use because nobody knows they're there. And what doesn't get used doesn't get refunded. So I spend a lot of time working with universities. I was at Carnegie Mellon last year at their suicide prevention conference for higher education. I have been at different corporations working with them for how to keep their employees, and then within the prison system, working with guards that are current reservists or actively serving, making sure that their mental health needs are met and that they're understood by their supervisors. Group is culture. We're a culture. Waynesburg University is a culture. Anywhere where you have knowledge and awareness and skills and you have a shared set structure, right, of how we think, how we feel, how we do, that's a culture. Okay, so I apologize, some of these are fast, but I did want everybody to see what is going on as far as internationally what's being presented without going into the clinical nitty-gritty, because you guys are not going to go out and see patients later today, I don't think. Maybe, but probably not. Unless I fall on my face getting off the stage. How does our own cultural experience affect how we engage people that are in a different culture? Where do you get your information from on veterans? Who here has seen Lone Survivor or a TV show, right? And been like, man, that's what it must be like. The movie Thank You for Your Service was my unit when I was in Baghdad. I was deployed with that. So when I watch that movie, I see it very differently. Because I was there from 2007 to 2009 running convoys with them. But what you don't see is the other 3,300 members of that unit that came home and had different problems and were functional and okay. That movie can't show all of that. It can just show a few. And so we get our cultural definitions off of just a small amount of information. And it does a disservice to that culture. Who here has heard from family members what the military is like, right? My family schooled them. I commissioned because my grandmother was a World War II officer. In the Women's Army Corps in World War II. She commissioned me. She told me, you'll never have to run, keep your uniform nice, and if you get married, they'll make you leave. And she was a nurse. And she married my grandfather, who was a doctor, and guess what? She had to leave. And she never had to run, and she thought field artillery were fireworks in the middle of Italy in World War II, working with patients. So I said, Grandma, I think it's a little different now. But that was her understanding of military culture, and she came to visit me at Fort Riley, commanding troops, and she was like, you're running with them and you're yelling. I know there's 800 of them in front of me. I have to project my voice, Grandma. I'm sorry. So you kind of get your information from different places, and that becomes your truth. I use memes a lot in what we see on Facebook because, let's be honest, how many students get all their information off of Facebook or like news outlets that you're going, that is not reputable. We as adults, just as guilty, right? So you get this idea that this is what it is. Suicide and stress and snipers and immunizations. Not that you don't get immunizations like that, because you do. But that's not all of it. So the so what for why anybody at Waynesburg should even possibly care about this. Who here knows about the Cemetery of the Alleghenies? National Cemetery in Western Pennsylvania. Does anybody know why? Jill might, but she's proofread for me on my dissertation so many times.
I'm sorry, I put a lot of things.
She helps me. I send her chapters, and I'm like, please tell me I'm not completely wrong. Help me. Second largest veteran population in the U.S. to Florida resides in Western Pennsylvania. You cannot walk 50 feet and not trip over a veteran in the state of Pennsylvania, let alone Western Pennsylvania. We have an Army Strong Community Center here. We have a National Cemetery here. We have a lovely commissary in Moon Township here because of the size of the population. So universities like Duquesne and Robert Morris have already become recognized as military-friendly universities on a national list because of the number of veterans that are currently coming into this area, even my age and younger, and those that are older and want to use their Montgomery GI Bill. And reservists get tuition remission as well. So they're all looking for places to go. So as an educator, you may have people in your classroom that you don't know they're a veteran or that they're a reservist. But by the sheer population here, you will eventually fall over one. People always say, wow, you're unique. And I'm like, no, there's like 400 more of me sitting in Moon Township on any given day. And many more than that across Western Pennsylvania. So understanding military culture, it's not just one culture. Some of these are funny, I put them up there for a reason, but every rank is its own culture. Officers, non-commissioned officers, warrant officers, the Navy and the Army. Anybody watch the Navy-Army game? Wow, we get mean. But those are cultures. You become very proud of your individual service, your individual rank, or your unit. My very first unit was quarter cab. I was one of the only females in a cab squadron. I got combat spurs. That was a big deal back then. People still think they're my husbands when they're on my desk. So women are a culture. And spouses, because I'm also that. My husband actually has 15 years of service. He's also a major, about to make lieutenant colonel. So we are a dual military couple, which is its own type of culture. And then children. My 10-year-old, who is a force of nature, who loves coming here with me because the cafeteria has fries and pizza. He's been through 5 deployments and he's 10. But he's incredibly resilient. He gets straight A's. And sometimes I use him as an example teaching subcultures, and I say, if you had a child in a classroom whose parents deployed 5 times and all these things happened to him, what would he be like? Do you think they're positive? Yeah. And then I say, actually, he's quite functional. He does very well. He likes origami. He's a little bit nerdy like his dad. He has ADHD, but he went to Carnegie Mellon Scholarship last year and built his own laptop. So he's doing okay. He's actually pretty resilient. Other than the fact that he bosses his little brother around too much. Cultural considerations, drinking. I grew up in that era 20 years ago where you went to Army school and you drank. They're getting away from that because poor decisions are made when drinking, but it is a part of the culture. A lot of people coming into academia feel as if they are not prepared. They have been writing in military writing style. If you ever get a paper and they capitalize soldier every time they write it, that's their writing style. It's short, it's succinct, it's only active voice. They're getting their point across and there is no fluff. And oftentimes people will come into higher education and say, I don't fit. First semester is when everybody drops because I don't fit. I can't do it. Structured environments. These are people that like a rubric. And in counseling, they like to know where they're going. What's our treatment plan? In presence of disabilities, I'm considered a disabled veteran. I can't hear everyone here, but nobody sees that, and I usually don't tell people. But I'm considered disabled. Something really loud happened in my younger days in Baghdad, and I lost part of my hearing and part of my vision, but I hide it really well. I don't tell anybody briefly until they know me for a few years. My students don't know. No one ever knew when I was getting a master's degree. It wasn't until I was teaching about disabilities and said that that people said, you? I said, yeah, I just got really used to turning my head. So I can hear it and I can read lips really well. And I have most of my vision, just not the peripheral, so my husband likes to throw a ball past my head at parties. It's like a funny joke. But I can hide it. Because I don't want people to judge me on that, but as a consideration, a lot of people that will come into counseling or into a classroom may have a traumatic brain injury. These types of lights drive people crazy. Loud environments, chaos, it being too hot. All of those things contribute to an environment where somebody may not perform well. And then sustained long-term stress. My entire dissertation is looking at reserve leaders who got out within the last 5 years to see if they had to deal with suicide over their career, because I've intervened 44 times thus far in my career. will that take a toll on somebody that's not a mental health provider when they're done? Physically, emotionally, psychologically, in their relationships? What does that do? Because accumulated stress is also a big part of this. It's not just combat. It's managing two careers. It's trying to take care of your family while you're 8,000 miles from home. It's being everything to everybody, and everybody looking at you like you're on a pedestal. And the female veteran, we make up 14% of the force. It's a pretty small number, but compared to 10 years ago, pretty big number, naturally. And 70% of veterans have completed higher education compared to 57% of males. So you're more likely to be a female veteran in a master's program or a PhD program than you are males. And 1/5 of women report sexual assault. And that is the one thing in the VA they do not care if you're deployed or not. If you go into the Pittsburgh VA and you have been sexually assaulted, well serving, they will take you in, no questions asked. I know the director of that program, and that was one of the biggest strides they've taken in the last 2 years. More likely to be a single parent, and we marry other military officers or other soldiers. I was telling my husband, who would want my schedule to marry me unless you understood it? So most women, if they are in long-term marriages in the military, will be married to another service member because societally it just works better. And women are more likely to ask for help. That's kind of cross cultures, I think, but for the sake of this, the female veteran is more likely to seek help in either counseling or in education. And language matters. It's succinct. There's an acronym for everything. Debbie Schratz, who is also a PhD student, her husband is Air Force, and occasionally when we get together for dinner, we try to compare acronyms and see what all they mean. Because they're completely different in the Air Force and the Army. But it's the same letters. Why? Why, I ask you? Basic language, and the biggest thing that I want to hit on this slide, and I usually do like 10 minutes here, but is passive versus assertive communication. Somebody might be asking you to like, well, tell me how I'm doing. And you're like, no, you're fine. You're fine. They're like, no, I really need to know how I'm doing. Because soldiers are used to being evaluated every year. And on your evaluation, it'll say, here's what you did great, and guess what? Here's what you didn't get great. And they're used to getting feedback every 4 months. And they come to education or counseling, and their counselor's just with them, and their teachers are so understanding, and they're sitting there going, how do I know if I'm doing well? Like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do to do well. So that's the biggest one that I hit is they don't want criticism necessarily, but they may be asking for what they deem as evaluation. I want to know where I'm going, how I'm getting there, and how I'm doing at it. Because that's been part of their culture growing up from the time they, at my age, I was 17 until I'm now 35. So it's been a big part of it. And addiction. I was at WVU last year doing an addictions institute. The veteran culture there, teaching them about how to work with addicts in the state of West Virginia. That were veterans. Because 3.8 million prescriptions for pain pills were given in 2009. Opioid addictions had a 300% increase in veterans in the last 10 years. Because when you're deployed and you're hurt, they need you back on the battlefield. And so they say, here's some Percocet, here's some Vicodin, here's what they call Ranger candy, which is 800 milligrams of ibuprofen and some caffeine, and go back upon your way. But then you come home. Now what? We've kind of created the problem, but now we're dealing with it. And part of that is what we're asked to carry and what we're asked to do. Across components, whether you're going up and down stairs in a submarine or on a ship, or you were carrying, in my time in 2007, I had 75 pounds of body armor and I weighed 140 pounds at the time. I was basically a turtle flying over backwards. There was no hope. I fell forward once in the mud and my soldier had to pick me up because I could not get up. But 75 pounds of gear and 140 degrees. It just takes a toll on the body. And so it has led to an addiction problem. It has led to a disability problem. And that's just something to consider if you're a student or if you're a counselor and you're working with a patient or a client. And I'm going to go into the last section. Is everybody with me? And am I still okay to go to do the last few slides? Perfect. So what we found out was people like to feel heard. It only took 10 years of research and $2 million, but we figured this out. People want to see themselves in their counseling session, in their classroom. They want to know that they're heard. I get lots of referrals every week because it'll say on my Psychology Today profile, veteran. They're like, oh, we found another one, we're good, right? People are trying to eye themselves up, trying to find themselves. And I've had students that will come tell me, even in undergrad, and in two of my grad courses, I'm a veteran, but I felt like I didn't want to say it before. Like, I didn't know, like, how to express that, but now I feel like you're hearing me. Because they can feel like they can match, like their opinion's not gonna be weird or awkward or stand out. The uniqueness is found this idea that when we use efficacy scales, even counselors with 30 years of experience don't feel as if they're doing their job well enough. It's like a 40% efficacy, that's pretty low. When we talk about people that have been doing this for a lifetime. And so these lovely researchers said, now what? Well, learn cultural competence. Just know the few things I hit on today, and you're probably gonna be all right. And then know how to ask questions. That's the last biggest piece, is what are we doing in our field to push forward, to do better, to meet people where they are? Well, the counseling, evidence-based, and multicultural counseling are two of the biggest terms that we have right now. They're huge in that field. So, when we evaluate it, we look at these things. Clinicians are stuck. There's an overprojection of, I can't understand, I'm gonna refer you to somebody else or send you to a counseling center or send you to the person that enrolls the veterans at the university because she'll get it. We're gonna do that. Soldiers are quiet. They're not gonna speak up and say anything if they don't feel like they're gonna be heard. And they're collectivists. It's very much buddy system. And soldiers are not what they are portrayed to be in the military. One of the hardest things I have, especially jail guards, come in and tell me is people look at me like I'm gonna explode and I'm freakishly functional. Like, I'm trying to deal with that part of people looking for there to be something wrong with me. There was a report that came out of the Washington Post this year that corporations have stopped hiring people because they're afraid of the mental health impact after hearing so many things about post-traumatic stress disorder and the op tempo, which is the deployment tempo of reservists deploying. You go every 5 years in some cases. I've been mobilized twice since I got off active duty in 2010. And so corporations and institutions are saying, I don't know if I want to deal with this. And now we have the largest homeless population in the U.S. is veterans. And people find it, they can't find a job because nobody wants to deal with the reserve schedule or deal with the mental health impact that they perceive will be there, even if it's not there. So we looked into what can we do as a group. And what we're doing with this is our current treatment implication of looking at barriers and strengths and then saying we need a better approach. We need a narrative approach. The narrative approach meaning how do we ask the right questions? What do we take as we need to understand? And how do we listen the right way? How much time do we give somebody? So the barriers right now are stigma. I've had my husband go for job interviews. He currently got laid off one job. He's put up a new job. And they'll ask him, do you get angry often? And he's like, I have 4 deployments, but not so much. Pretty calm guy. I coach hockey. I'm a Boy Scout tent leader. I'm pretty good. But his department got eliminated, so he's looking for a new job. Or at another place, they said, well, how long do you go away with the reserves at a time? So there's this stigma attached to it. Working with mental health providers, is this person dangerous? Because how many shooting or how many active shooter events have we heard in the last 2 years where the word veteran is tied to it? Navy Yard, Wheeling, it gets tied to that culture. Misunderstanding of repercussions for seeking treatment. People in the military used to think they'd lose their security clearance, they'd get in trouble. It's actually the exact opposite. They're kind of mad if you don't go now because you're not deployable if you're not well. They've purchased master resiliency training treatment from the University of Pennsylvania. Every soldier gets 24 hours a year of how to be resilient. Basically cognitive behavioral therapy wrapped up and given mandatorily to every soldier 24 hours a year. Culture change. I can beat this. If I had every year of pain as weakness leaving the body one more time in my life, I'd lose my mind. It was on the wall in college by the ROTC, and it's a lie, by the way. It is not. You need to ask for help. Fear of confidentiality, of things getting out. Guilt. I didn't make it home the way I thought I would. I thought my family would be different, or my friend didn't make it home and I did. I don't want to get help. I want to suffer through this. I feel guilty. And time and responsibilities associated with family, work, and education. I am the top calling the kettle black. So I'm a full reserve officer. I teach. I got to practice. Get the PhD. I got 2 kids. Got a husband. And there's just not enough time to focus on some of the things that need to be focused on, like mental health. I do counseling, by the way. I drink the Kool-Aid because I do it for a living. But there's not time. And a lack of professionals. People stop seeking treatment because they can't find someone to match their culture. Or they are afraid of the 4-hour wait at the VA. just to get the appointment, then at least the 4-week wait to actually see the provider. Strengths, incredibly cohesive. There are people I deployed with 10 years ago that I still talk to. I went to school in San Francisco 2 months ago, walked in, it was a reserve school, somebody stole my seat, I went to go say, hey, who does that to somebody? Guy looks up, and I deployed with him 10 years ago, his name was Ben. We actually switched rooms at one point between each other, and he was an active duty officer at a reserve school sitting in my chair. I'm like, what do you know? It does happen, serendipitous. Incredibly cohesive, though, he picked up like we never left off. Familial structure, people will say, you know, brothers and sisters, you see Facebook buddy check a lot, people just checking in with other veterans. Accountability, somebody will say they screwed up. And familiarity with the concept of suicide prevention. Every soldier across all components in the military gets 1 hour a year, and all leaders get 4 hours a year how to intervene. What other entity in the world does that? So people are already aware of this discussion of mental health, and there are a ton of resources. People don't realize that, and they're not getting used. How do we break through this? Cultures have to not collide. I'm a woman, right? Everybody tells me I'm very aggressive for a woman. I've heard this multiple times in the last 20 years. Now, I'm assertive for a human being. I just may be slightly aggressive for a woman, because when I talk more in a louder tone than when I'm directing people, not in counseling. Nobody runs out of my office. But because I tend to talk that way and say, okay, what's the solution? I've had people come back and say, aren't you a little aggressive? And female veterans get that a lot. Now, I'm assertive, and it's okay. I'm used to being with male counterparts all day, and I can be hurt. But I am still very nice. But yes, I will say what I need to say and move along for the day. Collective versus individual, this idea of warrior ethos. You know, we are a very individual culture now. Get my grade, move on, get the promotion. The military is still in this team squad idea, and so people will come out of the military and be like, well, shouldn't we be worried about everybody? And you're like, no, just get yours and go along. And it's a hard cultural shift. It's not that one is good or bad, they're just different. You go from this, you know, living communally, living on a post, being tied to your neighbors, being tied to everyone, to getting out and going to a very individual culture, which can be very different. And then this idea of I can never accept defeat versus moving on. People don't want to quit. And they also don't want to fail. So they would rather walk away or push themselves to the brink of mental health crisis than have to do what we would typically do in our culture, which is undertake a need, seek counseling, ask for help, ask for an extension on a project for your supervisor. We don't do that. And then I already get on the tone of voice. I am not very, I don't like confrontation, but I have no problem with it. Like I said, one female, 300 men at one point. It's part of my job. I don't go around fighting with people, but it is a misunderstanding of culture. So issues that happen at a therapeutic session, and Jane Owen and I did some work together last year for Committee Mellon, and these were also within the classroom. Traumatic brain injuries for people in the classroom in a counseling session, social isolation, hyperarousal, being like ready to kind of react to things, anger, irritability, chronic joint pain from carrying the 75 pounds of stuff, memory problems, issues with speaking, aphasia, personality changes, and body image issues are all things that are addressed across those domains. And environmental factors. Some people have a hard time concentrating, and that can come from a traumatic brain injury, hyperarousal, back to social isolation, no one's understanding, I'm not going to fit in. People don't like group work because they don't know how to fit into that new group. And subject matter may make people angry, especially with the political climate right now. Everybody kind of is on, and everyone's a little bit ready to go politically. And so some people are easily upset. And then people prefer a concrete plan. And some people have ringing in their ears in pain that affect how they can sit in the session or how they can even listen. I've had ringing in my ears for 10 years. I've just gotten used to it. But there were times when I feel like a whooping dog. Because I'm like, wait a minute, I'm good. My dog does that. I do the same thing. But if you're a professor or a counselor, you'd be like, what are they doing? So understanding that happens. And then moving forward, what do we do? Include military culture and education programs, especially counselor education. Focus on more than war. People are people. We have all kinds of stressors. Not everybody has PTSD. Now, that's not a huge issue, but there are resources already being driven there. Civilian life is hard, so focus on that as a huge transition. And then know that there's training available. The VA gives free training. Local commands give free training. I give free training. It's all over the place, nationally and regionally. And learn to create a narrative. This is the one thing, if you take nothing else out of here today, if you have a student, or you were a counselor, or you were volunteering, or you were in your church, and you were trying to reach a veteran, just ask some questions. Don't make assumptions. You wouldn't like when somebody assumes something about you. I don't like when somebody assumes something about me. Where did you serve? Where were you stationed? What did you do? Were you in combat? Do you have people that you love still deployed? We don't ask those questions, we make assumptions. All this research, all this time, the last 5 years of my life, and it literally comes down to, can you ask those questions? Can you get to know somebody as an individual? Treatment trends, I'm not going to hit on these, not everybody here is a counselor, but these are the biggest things that are happening across the country as far as training and what is paid for by the VA and SAMHSA. Mindfulness is a huge one. Meditation. An adventure. I like a nice high ropes course and kayaking myself. These are all of the biggest movements right now in the American Counseling Association. And the role of networking. Don't be afraid to volunteer. Don't be afraid to invite people in from a local unit, or if they're having a health fair day or education day, getting a table for that university is getting to know those units. The 316th ESC, which is the largest logistics command in the Eastern Seaboard, are tied into Robert Morris. They're there all the time. They're in their building. They're over there. Here you have units in West Virginia from Morgantown. There are units in Pittsburgh. There's an ROTC program. So just getting to know the students, getting to know the soldiers, and you know, being a friendly institution or a friendly practice or a friendly practitioner. And holistic care. If their university has the resources, and somebody is suicidal or somebody needs family help, or there's a phone call called Fort Family for reservists that will even cut your grass for you if you're deployed, you can help make those connections and fill the gaps that aren't being met. And then it's a win-win for everybody. We all understand each other. You get the skill set that the military brings in that service, and that veteran feels understood. And when there is a mental health issue like PTSD, you're set to have that discussion. Resources, Department of Veterans Affairs, and the Center for Deployment Psychology, Military OneSource, the JED Foundation, which is the second mention. Thoughts to ponder, policies changed. If you think you know what the military was now and you have not talked to anybody in the last 10 years, it's not the same. Changes, it evolves. Most people didn't know there was master resiliency training. Everywhere I go to talk, they're like, what? They teach soldiers how to talk? I'm like, yes, they really do. They want them to feel and talk and do this. That mindfulness is a practice and that we can capitalize on existing strengths across all domains. Thank you. I know I hit on a lot and I stuffed a lot into a very short amount of time. But I was really excited to present this because it is becoming a bigger and bigger topic in my field and across fields, as it evidenced by Fayette County Jail has me coming there next month. It's being able to do the Mental Health Academy. It's really, it's international. It's not just the U.S. having this problem. So thank you for your time, for putting up with me, and for being interested in my research. I don't have the answer, I will send you an email.
I have one, Michelle. How do you create a culture of advocacy in classroom? What have you done?
One of the biggest things is I have, at the beginning of every class, I ask my students to email me their learning style and any cultural things they want me to know about themselves. And when I explain that, I always say, if you're a veteran, if you grew up in a certain area, what's important to you? And I have them email that to me on the first class. And I go through those, and I use that for a discussion. We're getting to know each other as a group to infuse into the education. So if they are a veteran, bringing in some of those things so they can be heard, but doing it in a way that everybody learns about that culture. So even when I'm teaching biopsychology right now, there are certain lessons I use, there are certain TED Talks that hit upon those things so people feel heard in the classroom, but I still meet my teaching intent. Doesn't always work. I used Buffy the Vampire Slayer once, and I was too old, and nobody knew what I was talking about. And I was like, what do you mean you don't know who that is? And I was like, oh, yeah. I was like, I'm done. I'm very old. This is not
sound to me as optimistic in terms of treatment. Is that a fair assessment, or are you
an outlier?
Less optimistic.
I would not have been optimistic 10 years ago. I'll be honest. When I started in the field 15 years ago, I would not have been optimistic. I was the worst client coming back from Baghdad. I left my four-month-old. I deployed for a year. I came back a hot mess. I was a very unhappy person. My husband got deployment orders. And by the way, he got back, and I left 4 weeks later. That was, that was before I even left. He was gone when I was pregnant. And there were no services. And I was the world's worst client. I'm like, get me back the soldiers. You're wasting my time. You're wasting money. This is stupid. I look at my own record now, and I'm like, I wouldn't want to treat me. But in the last 10 years, and now policy has changed, culture's catching up with it. It's like, you need to be more optimistic. There are more programs. Neurocounseling and neuroscience have completely changed the game with traumatic brain injury and PTSD. If I would lay them up here for you right now, it would be a Venn diagram. And where do they meet in the middle? We can see the brain. We don't fully understand CTE yet for multiple traumatic brain injuries, but it is an exciting time. And so now we see more veterans making strides than before, at the VA as well as in my practice. I used to never discharge people. Now I'm using EMDR, using neurocounseling, using biofeedback, leveraging other services like the VA collaborating. I have people that are leaving and moving on, and they're doing very well. I have seen the military on the suicide prevention side where they used to throw people out. I have seen somebody I was very close to be suicidal. And the Ken Walter, who's actually on the education committee, he is the chief executive officer for the 316. He called me on the phone and he said, you saved all these people, you trained me how to do it, we're gonna make this a healthy event for that person. This will not destroy their career. And I thought, what a change. That this person who's making $100,000 a year managing all these people along with a two-star general sitting there telling me, they listen. And that person's going to be okay. So I am hopeful, because it wasn't that way 10 years ago. And I get a unique ability to sit where you sit, but also sit in that service and see what's happening day to day and what's changing. Do we have a long way to go because we're still 22 veterans a day dying? Yes, but we are far better postured today than we were 10 years ago. Does that make sense?
Sure does. Thank you.
Any other questions?
What's next for you?
I don't know. I want to teach, actually, full-time somewhere, so I've started applying to universities. I'm in data collection right now. As of this morning, 26 more surveys. I check every morning on SurveyMonkey, because I'm doing it nationally. Every morning I go in.
What is SurveyMonkey?
It is military leaders that got out of the reserve in the last 5 years. And what did they get post-pension training on suicide? If so, was it usable? And they were dealing with suicidal soldiers and with rape and with all of these things. What was the toll taken? Because they do not have a crisis debriefing for veterans right now. They only have on the active duty side. So I am trying to build that model for the Department of Defense. So hopefully I'll continue doing my practice. I love it. But I never thought I would want to teach. And then I started the PhD program. And Dr. Hepburn said, I think you're going to like to teach. And I said, I think you're crazy. It turns out I really did love to teach because it fit with my experience in the military. I was used to teaching soldiers. And I think that being in the military has made me a better teacher, and being a teacher has made me a better leader. So I would like to do that more moving forward in my life. So I have started to apply with some universities. I just am picky in the fact that I moved up active duty after living all around the world, and I'm not moving. So I will hold out until Miles is open, because my mother-in-law is here, my parents live next door, I live in Washington, and my kids walk to their grandparents. Mm-hmm. I'm not giving that up. I'll wait it out. But I have a research agenda that I'm working on. I'm trying to switch to be a MedCom officer. So work with the DOD as a psychological researcher. So the next 10 years are going to be exciting. But I know where I want to go, but it's all in God's time. Mm-hmm. Everything else has happened for a reason in my life, and I'm sure I'll end up exactly where I'm supposed to. If that makes sense.
You could just keep teaching for us part-time forever, please.
I don't know. I love stats, but my Harry Potter sorting hat needs replaced soon. But I love it, and I've gotten the best of all the worlds. I am incredibly blessed. But what I really want to do is make a bigger impact for everybody. So I've started working on a book called Palmer Conversations. I volunteer with Pitt, University of Pittsburgh. I speak for their law department. I've done two presentations for them recently on how faculty can work with at-risk students using positive psychology. So I'm working with them in their Pitt Bridge program. and I'm now going on to board of directors. We are actually teaching students how to teach stress management to each other, peer groups, and Steel Valley and other districts. So I'm just going to see which way I get pulled and hope for the best. But yeah, the practical part of me is like, I need benefits in a real job, but I'll take what I can get because I get to be my own boss.